I know a lot of us say, you know, save me, Jesus, save me, Ma, save me this, save me. But it's only our practice saves us, right? Because our only problem is continuity fear. We don't have any other problem. And only practice evaporates the continuity fear. Very simple. Our teaching here is very, very simple. We have one problem, it's continuity fear. We practice in the form of already. I've already done this. I've already cast aside all layers and levels. What is standing between us and bliss? The belief in layers and levels. I had a dream last night where the bliss body came to me, and I was carrying this piece of plywood, symbolizes layers and levels. And the bliss body was like, whoa, what's this? It was kind of backing away from me. And then I realized it was this plywood that was causing this problem. So I cast it aside. And then the bliss body came to me in complete confidence. So that's all that's standing between us and bliss is the belief in layers and levels. Okay. And why do we hold on to this? Continuity fear. Why do we hold on to layers and levels of belief in a continuity fear? The birds are clucking away there for some reason. I also saw in a dream last night, I saw why this world is going to go communist. There's no question about it. And oddly enough, it's the ones that will embrace it are the fundamentalist Christians, Old Testament Christians. Because they're terrified of Jesus. They don't want him to return yet. So they want to be distracted, saying, no, I'm busy with this, I'm busy with this. This is what I saw. I said, holy cow. They want an excuse. They said, no, we love Jesus, but we don't want him to return yet. And, oh, we got this problem here. So but they got into a relationship with communism. This is what I saw in the dream. And then I saw, okay, this is why. Is they've told themselves this lie that Jesus is this avenger coming to slaughter the wicked. And so they themselves, feeling themselves to be wicked, are terrified of this return. And so, they want to be embroiled in layers and levels and conflict and difficulty and relationships that excuses. They want to be embroiled in excuses, actually. So this was seen clearly. And then I had this experience where my whole body was suddenly unified into this vibrational feeling. My whole body was vibrating in exactly the same way. It was last night. It was this unified vibration. So here we are on the 23rd, and all this is coming to light. Now, as far as tossing aside layers and levels, well, I'm not analyzing it now. I know I've analyzed it many, 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 many times. So I'm just kind of in the wow of this. It's so don't struggle. If it doesn't come easy to you, if you don't feel you can just go into it and clarify it, that's called flipping the script mode. Don't go into the flipping the script mode. Don't pressure yourself into a flipping the script mode. Don't pressure yourself into that. It's very important to get real clarity. Don't try to don't stir the water up, because the water will get muddy again. Just relax. Full stop in the wow. Don't struggle with it. Hit my weight. I was just astonishing. I dropped a pound and a half yesterday. I don't know how. I feel very slim now, and I'm actually below the weight that I wanted to hit on the 24th. How about that? It is astonishing. So we refuse to go into any other problem except the continuity problem. I'd say this is the wisest path to take. We don't worry about ETs or this or that. We worry about our continuity problem. Now, we're aware that there's an attempt to distract us into layers and levels. but it's our own desire to be distracted which ultimately hooks us into this. We can't be hooked if we don't want to be hooked. And all that hooks us is our continuity fear. So practice is the absolute key. And by practice, we mean we have threefold practice: flipping the script, assertions, and full stop on the wow. So most people think that practice means you're sitting there chanting a mantra for 8 hours, for 10 years. No, that's robotic. We're not robots. Okay, we're experts in practice here. We're wise. And what we do is we're aware of how we feel. And right practice, you can say an assertion, and actually, if you really say it profound with conviction and believe in it, it can trigger a wow. Just that one assertion can trigger it, and then we're in the wow phase. So there's people that just say, they can get into some sort of mental state, trance state, by doing that or such. But we're not interested in that. We're interested with saying with conviction, and adamant, fiery conviction, and not even fiery, but just heart, core felt desire. You know, that this be so. That I'm making this assertion. That I'm really determined that this be so. This can quickly give rise to tremendous evaporation of continuity fear and a wow reaction from that. When we evaporate continuity fear, we get a wow reaction, and we have to allow this settle down and don't struggle mentally in any way. It's like we've rung the bell, and then wow, like that. So we gather our will, we ring the bell of assertion. The bell of assertion is vibrating. We feel this wow reaction. We let that cool off. And then eventually we get to flipping the script, where we're clarifying it for ourselves. So we're not robotic, and we're fluid, between what we're doing. We're always aware of these three aspects of our practicing. We're not just going to sit down and chant a mantra for 3 years. No, we could say something right now that settles it all. One insight settles it all, actually. This is an assertion. One insight settles it all. This is you might say, a root assertion. And I already perceive that perception is a choice, not a need. And one insight settles it all. So we could practice this. But by practicing, we're threefold practice of assertion, wow, and flipping the script. We're not, when I say practice, I don't mean we're going to say one insight settles it all for 30 minutes, and everybody says, and then people say, oh yeah, okay, I practice, I jog for 30 minutes. We're not joggers here. We're not devotees here. We're gurus. Okay? We are gurus. We're not devotees here. We're gurus. We're realizers. We're bliss body realizers. We're not devotees. A devotee will say, okay, tell me what I need to do. I need to chant this for 30 minutes. Oh, yes, okay, we'll chant this 30 minutes. And they'll say, okay, I did what you asked me to do. Now, can I get the reward? Can I get the cookie? Well, if your continuity fear is not evaporated, the bliss body won't come to you, because you will not cast aside layers and levels. And in the dream, I cast it aside. Jesus uses the term, I think, cast aside. Cast it aside. You mean gone. It's all, don't bit by bit say, well, let me, which layer do you want me to get rid of? No, I cast the whole plywood thing. I just cast it aside. And that was it. Like that. One insight settles it all. One insight settles it all. So the gurus know how to be aware of where they're at in the practicing. It's a threefold practice like this. It's not robotic. You don't do this first and that first and that first. Whatever arises, if you're in the flipping the script mood, you're working on that, and be aware that can lead right into a wow also. And then you may feel, you may be in a mood, very adamant mood for assertions. One insight settles it all. And then do that. And then when you may very quickly feel, wow, that just rang my bell. So you got to be aware when your bell gets rung. And that then realize, wow, okay, this is, I need to just sit quietly. The devotees are robotic. They want to be professional devotees. They, meaning what? Keeping layers and levels alive. They think, oh good, okay, you're up there and I'm down here. Great, let's make sure we keep that. And what do you want me to do? I'll do this as long as you're still up there and I'm down here. As long as you agree to be up here and down here. Well, Jesus does not agree to that. As Jesus asked, who wants to, you know, relate with him as friends? I said, okay, I'll do it. And I tried to bow to him and get down on the ground. And he bowed to me and he got down on the ground and he refused. He made sure he was on the exact same level as I was. He said, no. Friends are on equal level. Sri Sri Ananda Maima asked everyone to be her friend. They said, the best way is to view me as your friend, meaning equal. He says, you call me mother, you put me on a higher level, that means that's putting your belief in layers and levels, which is arrogance. There's no layers and levels in reality. So believing there's something that doesn't exist in reality is not ignorance, it's arrogance. Okay, so we make this very clear delineation. We are not ignorant, we're arrogant. There's no ignorance in anyone. There's only arrogance. Nobody's stupid. They're arrogant. And as Jesus said, you must repent to recognize your sin is spiritual pride. And then you're able to cast all this stuff aside, realizing it came from my arrogance. It didn't come from God. Perception didn't come from God. It came from my arrogance. So this is essential, very essential. So we're gurus here, practicing to remember that we're gurus. Oh yeah. I'm already a guru. Yes, I know I'm already a guru. Not I know. Yes, I'm already a guru. I perceive. I'm already perceiving that perception is a choice, not a need. And all things are simply echoes of silence, you might say. Echoes of silence. Beautiful decorations of silence, of intrinsic spaciousness. So devotees, they love the guru to be higher than they are. And this just feeds their arrogance, actually. Feeds their arrogance. Oh, it's a quail. Oh, this quail suddenly appeared right through a bush. I've never seen this before. It's looking right at me right now. It's walking right towards me right now. This beautiful, beautiful quail is walking right past me. Oh my gosh. That was a quail. That is extraordinary, folks. We have not seen a quail walk since in 40, 50 years. Oh my gosh. How extraordinary. A beautiful, right out of the hedge, a quail suddenly walked right into the path here. With a beautiful black head with white lines on it and a crest on its head like this and the beautiful markings. Oh my gosh. It walked down the pathway there. Oh. And of course, quail walk, don't they? They can fly, but they walk and they run. So it was the quail that was making that odd sound. Now, we used to see quail here back in the 60s. We haven't seen quail here since the 1960s. Now, I've noticed there's some quail out in the front yard. Occasionally, I notice them. But this is the first time I've ever seen one up close like this. And it saw me. It clearly saw me. And it just, since I was sitting still, it just walked right past me here. 5 feet away. It was just looked at me and said, okay, you're no threat to me. I'm going to walk right past you. Holy cow. That was so extraordinary. I can't tell you. That was extremely symbolic. The ones that can fly but choose to walk, the gurus into the super gurus in the world, coming into the world here, suddenly appearing. It was just extraordinary. It just popped out of the shrubbery. I just looked, and it was right there on the edge of the shrubbery, just looking at me. And it wasn't afraid of me. I wasn't afraid of it. What a sleek, elegant looking, quail that was. Beautiful. That was stunning, very stunning. So I won't go try to chase the quail. I'll look for it. I'll just sit here. Maybe it'll come back. I'll just say hello, good morning. Thank you, quail, for showing up like that. That's just... I remember as a kid in the 60s here, there'd be quail in the backyard. We'd see them. But we haven't seen them since. 46 years, maybe it's been, or a long time. I can't even remember the last time I saw one. That's the closest I've ever been up close and personal to a quail like that. Usually they're you know, they're a little bit of distance, they run away into the bushes. This one walked right past me on the path. And since I didn't move, it didn't run away. So this sitting quietly like this is extremely important. The our great heritage of teachers that have taught us correctly have really emphasized what we're emphasizing, full stop in the wow. Assertions, full stop in the wow, and clarification. Flipping the script, I call it. And the willingness to sit quietly like this in the wow enables us to receive the super grace. Oh, that crest that on the head of the quail, that beautiful crest on the top of its head. Oh my gosh. And the squawking, I think, had to do with a robin or something that was there. And the quail was, da 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 da, this is my place or something. I don't know how that worked. And then the robin flew off, and then the quail walked along here. So, when the guru emerges, when the super grace emerges, what do? Well, we practice. We say, thank you. You're here in support of our practicing. Because that's what we do. We're practicers. We're not robotic practicers, okay? We're not devotee practicers. We're intelligent. We're intuitive practicers here. Now, I did a little workout this morning. I walked backwards. I ran sideways. I jogged backwards. I walked backwards, jogged backwards, ran sideways, did all sorts of different... See, we're not joggers. If you're out jogging, jog straight a little while, then pirouette, and then run backwards for a little while, and then pirouette, go forwards, and go backwards. So we live in a robotic society. Extremely robotic society. So we need to keep on doing stuff that, little stuff, like I did this morning. You don't have to make a big deal publicly about it. I saw that man walking backwards yesterday, and that struck me. I said, that is so right, what he's doing. He's different. He was very different. He wasn't robotic. This was a man of wisdom. I smiled at him, looked at him, but he was very, his face was all calm, and he wasn't really very relaxed. He didn't smile at me or anything, but he was very focused and relaxed and calm. Because he's doing something different than everybody else. And I see people doing different stuff. I pick it up from them. Yeah, I do. I got to stop being so robotic in the workouts. I'm going to focus on that. I'll go backwards. Now, again, this is artful. We're not kooky, okay? We're not kooky. We're super hip. I'm a super hippie. Okay, the hippies were wonderful. But, well, no buts. They were wonderful, okay? But super hippies are super wonderful, okay? So that's how we'll leave it. So I'm calling everyone to be a super hippie. And a super hippie is not just reprising the hippie role, but it's an artful spiritual intuitiveness based on wisdom and right practice, knowing how to practice in the right way, and allowing the Holy Spirit to guide what we do. Being very, very sober at all times. That's a super hippie. A hippie would walk backwards. Sure, a little bit. But they might walk backwards down a street or something. You know, well, that's, you know, that's putting on a show. Just walk backwards somewhere where there's nobody there. Okay, don't need to put on a show. So I tend to avoid crowds, people, etc. If you're going to do something a little different, do it somewhere where you don't startle the horses, startle the robots. You know, don't freak the robots out. Yeah, the freak is back, but we're not here to hassle the robots, okay? A lot of hippies got that. They didn't want to hassle people. Some you know, more activists wanted to hassle people, stir up chaos and stuff, but the real hippie said, no, I don't want to be robotic, I want to practice intuitively. So don't jog. I mean, jogging is a robotic action. You see people plod, 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 jog, 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 jog. Jog sideways. Skip. Jog on your toes. Snap your fingers. Hop up on a wall. Jump up on the curb, up and down the curb. You know, make it a work, overall workout of your moving this way, and you dance along. If you're jogging, dance along in some way. I mean, I don't see anybody doing that. Isn't that extraordinary? I mean, we don't realize how extraordinary our society is. It's an extraordinary society. So we acknowledge the extraordinariness of it, but we want something that's also extraordinary, different, but also extraordinary, okay? That's fine. We've developed a robotic society, which is quite extraordinary, quite at odds with what we are, quite a distraction from what we are, and that's quite extraordinary. So give the devil its due. Extraordinary society. Okay, great. I honor that, and I also choose to live in an extraordinary society of a different type, where we are freeing ourselves from roboticism, the habit of roboticism. More than that, we're freeing ourselves from the whole belief in layers and levels. That there's some depth to symbols, to contrast. There's no depth. That there's some depth to intrinsic spaciousness. There's no depth. It's everywhere. How can everywhere be said to have depth? It's a concept. There's only 360 degreeness. How is that depth? How are there layers and levels and intrinsic spaciousness? There aren't any. So we can do motions like casting aside the motion of just, I cast this aside. You can just be dragging down, you might just a little like that. You just make a gesture like that. Why don't we make gestures as we walk around? People think we're crazy. No. That's extraordinary. It's a different type of extraordinariness that frees us from roboticism. It helps. So you're jogging along. Don't. You can just do like a little pirouette and like, you know, I just toss that aside. I just toss it. Toss that aside. Toss it aside. I even do exercise. I'll do exercise now of just tossing aside. Swing something heavy and it's like, I'm just throwing that aside. I'm throwing that aside. I'm throwing that aside. There goes my layer and levels, just gone. Not evaluating, analyzing, okay, now what layers and levels, how do I get rid of this layer? Now the whole concept of layers and levels all tossed away as one concept. One false belief, layers and levels. One extraordinarily arrogant notion. Or, you know, just, you see kids, sometimes they'll just go boof like that. And they're just like tossing all the troubles away up in there that turns into confetti or flowers raining down. So take all regrets and just boof, throw them up and let them just rain down like this as flowers now. Kids love doing these things. They're in a different extraordinariness, kids, aren't they? And then we teach them roboticism. Say, well, we got something extraordinary here too in this world. Say, yeah, it's great. So we have a choice, don't we, between different types of extraordinariness. So we'll just, you know, we'll choose what we most want to experience, right? Freedom. So we don't want to, we're tired of roboticism. I'm tired of that. That was interesting for a while, extraordinary and interesting, but now, you know, I'm bored of it, tired. It just seems to lead to boredom. And so I'm going to different type of extraordinariness, right? Honoring our creativity. So as you're jogging along, you should just say, wow, why don't you stop and just go, wow, or toss it all aside like that. And then jog, 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 then wow, or toss it all aside. So this is, you know, what you need to do is take this robotic stuff we're doing and then just suddenly toss it aside. Practice tossing it aside. It's all gone all at once. One insight settles it all. This is very key. And having experienced this now, I can be an adamant advocate of it. One insight does indeed settle it all. So this is why tossing aside is gone. It's you know, 30 feet. We flung it across, and it's 30 feet away from us. It is simply gone from me now. I didn't like kind of carefully like, well, let me see how I can set this down. I just flung it aside. It's gone. Layers and levels gone. So practicing this motion, Gurdjieff did this in physical. There's certain physical things you can do, and you know we don't have to say, well, what did he do or this or that. No. He was an intuitive. He had something, awareness of something. Okay, that's great. We have awareness of something here. And so, but I'm just saying that throughout history, there have been those who realized you can do these sudden motions to break you out of this roboticism like that. Yeah. So movement can be used. It can be used. Some people use movement in their therapy and such. That's a therapy, but it's something that has to be incorporated in the root practice. Assertions, full stop, then wow, flipping the script. And then moving as you move, you can also do these things, but not in a robotic way, you know. So I just will just suddenly just throw it in while I'm doing something, you know, just in the spur of the moment kind of thing. And I'm at a gas station, I'm doing these kind of pull-ups on this U-shaped bar they have at a gas station to protect the gas pumps. I use that, and I lean back, and I pull myself up, lean back, and this lady's looking at me, what the heck is he doing? But I just keep doing it like this, and then she goes, oh, he's doing a workout, okay, no problem. As soon as she gets it, she says, oh, okay. And maybe in her mind saying, oh, that's unique, that's unique. So a lot of people have seen me doing that. Nobody does it. Nobody does any exercise at the gas station. I'm the only one I've seen doing that. I stretch. I do all these stretching exercises. But this is a new workout I found. And it takes, I did do it, you know, it takes 30 seconds or whatever. I did 20 of them last time. That's pretty good. I'm getting stronger. But it's just these little intuitive spur of the moment recognitions. I'm gonna do something, a little something. And just little by little by little, you're breaking free of this roboticism. This extraordinary roboticism. It's quite an extraordinary accomplishment to distract ourselves from reality, is it not? And we all kind of want to, people say, well, why don't we sit around and worship? Well, we've already been sitting around worshiping it for a long time, actually. So it's been worshiped plenty. You know, and the point is, the worshiping is designed to distract us even more. But, you know, being distracted from our creativity and freedom is very boring and actually very fearful. And you know, for me, I'm tired of that. But you must make sure that the countermeasures don't become robotic. and that they do. That's the yoga girl thing. They said, yeah, spiritual positive. Let's we can be spiritually robotic, and everything's fine. No, that's not it. Let's organize a class. Let's get to the institution. Let's all do this, okay? And then it becomes robotic again. So you must, on your own, have your own deal going on, right? This is what the hippies did. They said, do your own thing. Meaning, let's break free of roboticism and let's not make it the counterculture robotic. So do your own thing. Do your own thing. Meaning, you might be walking along a trail and you just might want to stop and talk to a stone or something. Fine. That's your thing. To break out of roboticism, do it. Somebody else may not feel like doing that. They might like be throwing twigs aside. Boom. Boom. Tossing twigs aside. Picking something up, toss it aside. Pick up, toss it aside. Somebody else may be doing something else. So you have to do your own thing. That's a super hippie. Realizes this. As long as you keep institutionalizing everything, it just becomes robotic again. Boilerplate spirituality is not liberating. I know all religions have this boilerplate speech, and they seem, you know, the priests seem so nice. The Rinpoche seems so nice, and everybody, but they have this boilerplate, and it's all pretty much the same. It's kind of same spiel. You must understand this. I'm sorry. You know, you're going to be worried. You know, this and this and that and that. And I realize that they're all given the same spiel, just like Catholic priests are given the same talk, and they're very nice, and earnest, and what they say. You know, you think, wow, that's very profound, but is it robotic? Is the question? Are they really free, or is it just, you know, boilerplate? It's a question, right? I noticed this. All the Tibetan spiritual leaders, they tend to speak, say basically the same thing. Like it's boilerplate. Most of them do. There's some that you can feel the adamancy and you know they're enlightened, actually. But the others seem very profound, but they don't quite seem enlightened. And they're saying this boilerplate. And I say, how is that any different from Roman Catholic priests who seem, or They seem very earnest. Yes, they are. They seem very nice and compassionate. Yes, they are. And they're very skilled in what? Reciting the creed and the dogma of the church, which seems very profound, right? But they're all taught this in theology school, and they're all, you know, super schooled in what to say. And it's very robotic. And when you go off script with them, they're like, does not compute. Now, that's not going to get you free. Because we have to realize our own freedom, not someone else's freedom, our own freedom. Everybody else is trying to, we're all trying to liberate somebody else and not liberate ourselves. For we have to experience our own freedom and then show others that it's safe to do so. And then they will, that'll help them experience their own freedom. We can't force anybody to be free. So we have to experience our own freedom. Everybody say, oh, you go first. I don't want to go, I'll liberate you, So we're gurus here. We're experiencing our own freedom. So will I go running through the neighborhood here doing all this stuff? No, probably not. Which is why I don't like running through the neighborhood. Because I end up feeling very robotic because, you know, all the neighbors are looking at who, you know, who's that? Okay, someone's jogging. Okay, fine. But if you're like going sideways and snapping your fingers, you know, they're going to like call 911. You know, like, what? That's different. What's that? So it's better to go somewhere where you're, there's not all that social pressure on you. This, where someone was walking backwards, they were out in a place where nobody really could hardly see him. And it's just like, oh, it's okay, yeah. I saw him. When I was skipping, there was only like two people or three people that saw me. And I was like, oh. They're like they just saw like, yet, you know, Bigfoot or something. Like, what? What are you doing skipping? They're like, oh, let me turn my smartphone. Says, Siri, what are you, Siri, there's somebody skipping here. You know, they were kind of like that. What do I do if someone skips, Siri? So they kind of like, they kind of wandered off. They're looking at their smartphones. Of course they click, so, and then they wandered off, look at their smartphones like, please advise Siri, somebody is skipping by me. Skipping. Skipping is a type of exercise that young children usually do. I don't have so much else to, huh? These robots, you know, they're trying to be extraordinary robots. Well, it's just, they're using their creativity to try to get rid of creativity, which is an extraordinary, you know, extraordinary, but it's just that. And, you know, you don't get rid of your creativity. It's just an adventure into sickness and fear and boredom. And that's all it is. And it's extraordinarily weird and awkward, yes. And then we say, okay, had that experience, and now we're moving on to another extraordinary experience. Thank you very much. Don't get angry at people. Whenever you see something happen, say, okay, this is Holy Spirit getting my attention. What is this? What does this draw my attention to that's important? And you can use that as a focus. Actually, a lot of crazy drivers here now. And I just say, thank you. You're reminding me of something. Quail hasn't come back. Well, that quail just walked past here. But I'm settled down now, ready for it to reappear if it wants to. Wow. You see how the wow, you just kind of You stay calm, you stay centered like this. You give yourself a chance to work through the real startling stuff. Our freedom startles us. Our true nature startles us because we've been in this extraordinary denial of it. So we have to be able, when we're really startled, we have to have the confidence we can just sit quietly. So the confidence that you can sit quietly like this and not move is the most important aspect, I would say, of all practice. And this is what the great realizers in the past have told us. Sitting quietly. Someone asked Punjaji, "What if I want to reach enlightenment really fast, what is your best recommendation?" Punjaji says, just sit quietly. That's the fastest way. He's absolutely right. That in itself can do it. But of course, we're not going to just sit in a cave for 40 years silently. But the principle of what he's pointing out is, this is the core practice is to sit quietly, be able to sit quietly, doing nothing. And then when you're able to do this, guess what? These shocking insights will arise. They'll just arise like bubbles, like corks coming to the surface, like, wow. And then it'll rock the surface. This bubble popping on the surface, you know, rocks the surface. And the emergence of our creativity from what we thought was a frozen state of death. I was reading something this morning, posting on Facebook about Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. And I had read this before, but I'd sort of forgotten it. But they're talking about her awareness of the invisible realms and what's taking place there. She's very aware of all that. And she was explaining how it works. And then they also mentioned that she, I think it was in Almora, 1957 or something like that, around noontime, someone came back to see her, and she said, if you had been here earlier, you would have walked in this room, you would have seen that this body and this bed was not here at all. And she said, I transported myself into the invisible realm, and whatever was touching me went with me at that point, and just simply became invisible. And she said, I went to the what you call the invisible realms. Completely. My body was not visible here at all anymore. And then she reappeared. The body and the bed reappeared in the room. And she just matter-of-factly just say this, and that's all. People would say, okay. And she says, this is entirely easy. She says, if you can make anything invisible, you can, then a small thing, the big thing is the same. No difference at all. So I said, hey, Ma, you know, if you can just disappear into the invisible, you can reappear, can't you? Like that quail just suddenly reappeared after 40 years or something. It's been a long time. How long has she been gone? 82, 92, 102, 112. 34 years? So maybe it's been 34 years since we've seen a quail. It's very likely that 1982 might even be a little longer than that. So, but after a long absence, let's see, 34, you know, maybe 30, 40 years, something suddenly reappears. This is what just happened here. It was so astonishing. Black signifies the invisible realm. There was a beautiful bird there. What markings. And how sleek it was, and large and fat and plump and healthy. Wow. Like a guru suddenly emerging. From the invisible realm. That was exactly what it symbolized. So this is, that was extraordinary. It symbolizes, and reading that quote today from Anandamayi Ma, where she was talking, oh no, there's a cat here. So, well, the cat's saying, where's the bird? It's not, you can't find it, can you? It's smelling, 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 trying to smell. This cat is a huntress, but the quail is departed. Fascinating. Where did the quail go? Looking for birds. It's going around. It sees one right now, as a matter of fact. It's trying to catch one right now. But I think the bird may have flown away. Yeah. So the willingness to just sit here and do nothing is the whole core of practice. Without that willingness, the fruit will not develop. The fruit will not ripen. Because ripening fruit is quite startling to us. And we say, wow, what a shock. I thought that our creativity was dead. It's like, what a shock, I thought I was dead. I mean, I, meaning creativity, genuine creativity, spiritual creativity. I thought spiritual creativity was dead. The real creativity is just whatever the mind desires, that's what we experience. And the creativity that we have, materialistic creativity, that's pretending that our spiritual creativity is dead. Because if it was alive, we wouldn't be creating this way. That's stupid. It's ridiculous. Materialism is completely ridiculous. Materialism is acting as if our spiritual creativity is dead, that mind is dead. And so we have to create this way now. You know, our spiritual creativity is dead now. All we have left is this materialistic creativity of bodies and stuff. It's all play acting. It's just pretending. Our spiritual creativity is not dead at all. So the sudden emergence of that quail, I mean, I'm in the wow of this very strongly, because that's the emergence of the guru, super grace. As I've said in the previous video, I've been assured that the cure to these times is the emergence of the super gurus, the super grace in the form of the gurus, their emergence. This is what it was indicated to me yesterday. I said, okay, I see what the problem is. What's the answer? The emergence of super grace. And it'll happen very, very soon. And this quail suddenly emerging after all these years. We completely forgot about quails. Really. I mean, I someone said, yeah, they used to be in the yard. I said, huh? I completely forgotten about that. I only vaguely remember them. But they're coming, and then I noticed one day, I said, hey, there's some quails. And there's some quails in our patio. And they're walking around the patio. I said, oh my gosh, look, the quail are back. And it's like a big deal for us, because we thought they were gone forever. We thought the quail would be gone forever. No, they're back. The gurus are back. Super grace is back. So the hippies were doing their own thing, breaking out of roboticism. Then they went to see the gurus, but they kept on. Well, some of the quote unquote gurus were merely robotic, spiritually robotic, and the hippies didn't like that. So there was conflicts there. Some hippies went, a lot of the real hippies went into spiritual practice. And the goal is to be a super, that's what I did, super, super hippie. I said, enough of this hippie thing, let's get down to business here. You know, we can't just fritter our lives away in amusements, just pretending that we're hip. That's a means to an end, not an end in itself. One insight settles it all. One insight settles it all. Bam. One insight settles it all. One insight settles it all. One insight has indeed already settled it all for me. One insight has indeed settled it all. Meaning, I've already experienced this fact. One insight has indeed settled it all. Got to do errands today, and so got up early, did a workout, doing taping. So, you know, working around the roboticism of the day, which is to come. Don't like that. Got to go to a place that's all very robotic. Terrible. People there are very robotic. See, we think that layers and levels will protect us from reality. That's how he protects it. Oh yeah, I've got a long ways to go. There's a lot of layers, a lot of levels. I've got to work through this. God's going to take me many lifetimes and all this. This is all very comforting to us. Now, it's true. If we keep believing this, it will take lifetimes. The lifetimes are merely because we believe in this. So reincarnation is, of course, it's our own doing. It's not God reincarnating us. It's our own doing. We keep thinking God's sending us back here to learn more lessons. No. God doesn't never send us anywhere. This is our own doing. Because we believe in layers and levels. Our continuity fear says, "Oh, I'm afraid of, you know, freedom and true creativity. I don't want to. It's too much freedom. So I gotta believe that it's a layer. It's a higher layer. I'm in a lower layer. This is how we delude ourselves." So as long as you believe that, you'll keep reincarnating into some layer, some level, striving to reach a higher level. And this goes on and on and on. As long as you're striving to reach a higher level, you will reincarnate. Whatever that level may be, even if it's Buddha level, you'll still reincarnate. Buddha mind is recognition there's no levels. There are no levels. They claim that they use the term self. This is a strange term, because some use it self to mean reality, and others use it mean the ego. So you don't know which one are they talking about here. It's very confusing for people, isn't it? The term the self. Buddha mind is maybe a better term. Christ mind, Christ consciousness. Christ consciousness, Buddha mind, no layers or levels there. Now, is that a matter then you reach the highest layer? No. You only, Buddha mind is not reached. It's when we toss aside the belief in layers and levels, we realize there's only Buddha mind. Layers and levels was just a dream. It never existed at all. So we never left Buddha mind. No one's ever left Buddha mind. So Buddha mind's not attained. It's realized no one's ever left it. So it's not attainment, but realization. We can say we attained the realization if you really want to, if you hung up on words. But it's more important to just feel this fact that Buddha mind is not the highest level. As long as we believe in levels, we will continue to reincarnate in order to believe that we can reach a higher level. And having this body and makes us think like, oh yeah, there must be higher levels than this body. Ramana says, we never had a body. We never incarnated. Real liberation is to realize we never were born in the first place. It's the only liberation. liberated. We liberated from the false notion of layers and levels, that there's ever been any. There's never been any. So we keep trying to have relationships, special relationships with those that represent a different layer to us. We might have a special relationship with someone who's quieter, can sit quietly. We say, oh, that's wonderful, that helps me. Or have a special relationship with somebody who's just very active all the time. But all of this is doing is just saying that we believe in layers and levels. The real relationship is 360 degreeness. There's only relationship. There's this 360 degree relationship every moment. And the relationship is with our own creativity. Wow, that quail, like that made a vivid impression upon me. There was all this clucking. You heard the clucking in the background. I said, what is that? I hadn't heard this before. I said, this is an odd sound. I let you hear it because I wanted you to hear that. And then, oh gosh. So all this, we're hearing a lot of non-dual clucking in the background, aren't we? It's really in the air now, so much so. Well, guess what? That precedes the sudden appearance of the guru, of super grace. Suddenly super grace will just appear one day for us. Could be today, could be tomorrow, very soon. And it's here. And they may say, well, I just appeared. I say, well, that's great. So I'm just going to wow that, and we'll practice along those lines or whatever you suggest. That means you're simply using true creativity instead of trying to, you know, destroy it. That's all. So we welcome you. We welcome your appearance here. People pride themselves in this world on being robotic. Yeah, I just want to be very robotic, don't let anything interfere with me. So as they're walking along, they're that way. Whereas a kid, they'll see a bush or something, and they'll like kind of bend under the bush like, you know, like that, and go underneath it and say, oh, that was fun. They'll see a curb, they'll hop up on the curb and hop down on the curb like that. They'll see a leaf, they'll bend over to pick it up, and then they'll, you know, toss it up in the air and watch it fall down. So they're walking along, they're seeing stuff, and they're, hey, Dad, hey, Bob, look at this. And they'll run over here, do this. And the parents are saying, oh, you know, we got to be more robotic. Come on, come on, come here, come here, come here. Just stay one foot in front of the other. You see that obstacle? No, you just stay away from it. The kid says, but I want to dance underneath it. No, you got to be robotic. So we're all trained to be robotic, aren't we? Mothers are always there saying, no, don't do that. No, don't do that. No, don't do that. The hippie mothers were less robotic. They'd say, that's okay. You want to dance with the leaves? Go ahead and dance with the leaves. But then that can become, be turned into a ritual or a frenzy or something. You know, that's robotic also. That's not really creative. It's just in the moment. The child's in the moment, and then it's dancing off into something else. does not say, let's make a ritual out of dancing with the leaves. You know, we will bring the candles and the incense and we must dance with the leaves and stuff. No, that's robotic. That's setting up a robotic ritual. The kid danced with the leaves. Now he's look, you know, shuffle, you know, kicking sand as he's walking along, kicking sand, and walking on his knees. Like, oh, I want to walk on my knees now. What are you doing? I'm walking on my knees. What? Okay. Now the kid's skipping and clapping. And then laughing. Then he sees a cat walking, stops. Sees a cat walking, then he starts walking very gently like the cat. Yeah, walk like a cat. You know how kids, they love, I think young kids, the teachers take them out and they say, okay, we're going to walk like various animals. So we want everyone to walk like an elephant. Boom, boom, boom. What would it be like to walk like an elephant? So they walk like an elephant. What if you walk like the dog? Duk, 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 trotting, kind of like this. What about a cat? Oh, nice and soft and gentle like this. Okay. And different animals, you know. How about a tortoise? Walking like this. So kids love those type of games of imitating like different stuff and say, oh, yeah. See? But how, when's the last time we walked like an elephant? Or walk like that bird's walking. Doop, 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 hop, 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 hop. Hop, 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 hop. Yeah, kids delight in that, don't they? They love it because they're exceptional. They come from a realm, another exceptional realm, different than this one. They've been in that for a while where they're much more creative. A kid sees some leaves or something, and they'll stop working. What are you doing? Ah, I'm building a little house. You know, I'm using this leaves and these twigs, and I'm making a little something. You know, I'm just putting something together here. And then when they're done, poof. You know, okay, off to the next thing. So everything they see, you say, oh, okay, that's it's like a game. Okay, so that's that little weed there. Okay, that represents this. I see a puffball. I say, oh, they pick it. Poof. They see how they laugh and say, oh, that was fun. And on to the next thing. And so this is like creativity, this non-robotic. Jesus said you need to be a little, like a little child to enter the kingdom of heaven. This is what he's talking about. You cannot be robotic and enter the kingdom of heaven because kingdom of heaven is 360-degree creativity. It's never fixated, actually. He's saying, like a little child. He's referring to what we're talking about here. Is you play and then set down the play. You do another play. You never get attached or fixated that I need this play to be what I am. It has value because without it, I'm not creative. There's no such thing as without this particular creative display, that means I'm not creative. It doesn't work that way in reality. Another nice, cool morning. We've really had not much heat at all this summer here. We had a few days in the 90s. It got up just a couple days, but mostly it's been quite very temperate, like just low to mid 80s with cool mornings. So it's just like, wow, very beautiful. Now, as far as practicing, there you could say there's a couple aspects to it. In order to be a super hippie, first you have to be a hippie, basically. So you may want to have somebody coaching you, like, okay, we're going to skip around the pool here, skip around this path. And you get out, and every day you're skipping. This helps bust you out of roboticism, okay? Because I'm doing, wow, I didn't know I could do this. This is great. But then you have to be very careful you don't turn that into a new roboticism. Like everybody, we have to go skipping along. If that was the case, if everybody skipped along, then the people were like just jogging. They'd say, hey, I'm really hip because I'm not robotic like all these people. All they're doing is skipping along. So first you got to break the ice, but then it has to be understood that you have to be more into doing your own thing at some point. And be aware of just how do I feel, what's the situation. But and be creative with it, yeah, your own creativity. So some institutionalization is necessary to help us out of roboticism, keep reminding us of it. And then, but then there's also the phases of more you're more self-guided. All this is understood. But sitting quietly is really important. This is not a robotic sitting quietly. It's a determination. There's just as much determination involved with sitting quietly than there is climbing up a hill. If you see that steep mountain and you say, I'm going to climb up that today, wow. You know, you get this fierce determination. I'm going to do this. Let's do this. And you set yourself and resolve, and you go into the state just of determination. It's similar with sitting quietly. You really have to bring your resolve to it, and resolve that this is very important. That I'm going to do this. So, it's a type of exercise, you might say. It's like exercise, except we're not trying to exercise the body. We're giving an opportunity for the insights to arise, and then being able to wow it. It's difficult for us when we're involved in activity to wow insights, which is why the communists want everybody to be constantly working like robots, producing stuff all the time. So, no, you can't interfere with the efficiency. Because you might just say, wow, I got to take a break. I just got to sit here quietly. No, get back to the assembly line. So all this materiality is just an excuse. Body's an excuse. Materiality is an excuse to remain robotically engaged and deny the wow, which is really denying the insights that are rising, which insights are really just echoes of our freedom, our free creativity, just echoes of that. And when you hear this echo, you say, wow, what an echo that was. Wow, I just got this echo from... All we get in this world are echoes, actually. But you can get some beautifully clear echoes, and these, you know, just will hit you so hard. It just wow. Even the bliss body in this world is an echo of genuine bliss, the great bliss, as Sri Sri Anandamayi said. There's a beyond the bliss body here is the great bliss. But she says you cannot remain in this world and be in the great bliss. It's not possible. So the bliss that we're experiencing here, the bliss body, that is an echo of the great bliss. But we certainly can get a very clear echo going of the great bliss. Absolutely. A continuous echo, actually. Now, religions are very set in their ways. There's no question about it. I noticed this: Christianity, Hinduism, Buddhism, and other traditions, very set in their ways. And I don't see them moving out of their ways at all. I'm ecumenical. I'm super hip, so I'm not bound by any religious approach, actually. I don't feel bound at all. I understand what right practice is, and I do it.